Welcome back to Talking Guitar, brought to you by the Carter Vintage Exchange and the North American Guitar in Nashville, Tennessee. Lindsay here, and this time I'm sharing a rare in-person chat with the wonderful Jeff Jewitt. Even if you've never played a Jewitt guitar, odds are very high another guitar you own bears an element of Jeff's work, because he has been the go-to guy for finishes and colorants for everyone from Gibson, Taylor, Martin, Santa Cruz, and more for many years. But in addition to supplying the big names, he's been handcrafting his own guitars from his spacious workshop in Cleveland, Ohio, creating a diverse array of guitars that uniquely blend elements of Martin and Gibson with plenty of modern influences. In collaborating with incredible players like Matt Thomas and trading tips with fellow Ohio luthier Ryan Gerber, Jeff is constantly taking on new challenges and expanding his craft. As mentioned, this was an in-person chat, so if you're listening on the podcast app, be sure to check out the YouTube video version for some more workshop footage and photos. Now, please enjoy my chat with Jeff of Jewitt Guitars. Thank you so much for having me here at your workshop to do this little interview and this little tour.
Yeah, welcome to Jewitt Guitars. Lovely downtown Cleveland, Ohio, one of the oldest commercial buildings in the city, believe it or not. And got a lot of character here. I guess maybe if I can talk Lindsay into it, we'll give you a little tour later.
Oh, definitely. Something like that. For sure.
Cool. Yeah. But welcome. Thanks for coming up.
Yeah, my pleasure. This is a little side trip I get to take to pick up a client's guitar and get to... We had you down in Nashville last year, but the interview unfortunately was interrupted by a lot of jackhammering, so this is the makeup interview, but I think it's benefited because we've had that much more time to, you know, to get to know each other through emails and Instagram and the past interview, so this will be a better interview.
Yeah, I agree. That was a hard one to go because there was so much happening outside.
Yeah.
And anyways, but yeah, so... what we did is Lindsay kindly offered to come up and actually pick up a guitar for a client that I just finished building. And she's going to carefully take it back to Nashville today. And then we decided, well, we'll let do an interview while she's here. So
yeah.
I guess fire away.
Well, the first questions I always like to start off with are the kind of get to know you questions. Mm-hmm. So yeah, let's talk about how you got into guitar making.
Well, I was, again... I went to college in 1972, and you know it was the golden era of guitars, acoustic guitars. Crosby, mm-hmm. Stills, and Nash was a super group. John Prine had just come out with the first album, on and on and on and on. Everybody had a guitar in my dorm room, except me. And so I had to get a guitar. And the funny thing was, as I was learning to play it, I was also a studio art major at the time. I just kept wondering, how the heck do you make one of those things? I mean, that's just, it seemed so complicated. So I had that headworm for, as many years as I can remember. And then I just started sort of saying, well, maybe I can do this. And so I started researching. And there was very little out at the time when I started in the mid 80s. So I bought a kit from the Martin Guitar Company. And I put together using, I think, cinder blocks, bricks, and Elmer's glue or something like that. It came out okay. But then the William Cupiano book came out. And that was just a godsend for people like me because it had really the step-by-step instructions to make a complete guitar from scratch. So I built several guitars, called myself a luthier, started advertising, and it really wasn't happening quick enough for me and my wife at the time and our new house mortgage and a lot of other things. So I gravitated towards other things and returned to guitar making, believe it or not, about 14 years ago, because it's what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And so I sort of folded my existing business, which is I make a lot of colorants for the musical instrument business. I folded my... guitar making business into that, and here we are.
Yeah. I mean, that's, you have kind of a unique position, like having been part of that industry for so long, and then it does kind of dovetail so nicely into that. And yeah, you have this massive workshop space that you're able to kind of transition into building. So it's a really interesting combination of things that you do. And so did you start doing the colorants and the stains pretty early on? Was that sort of the first business pursuit that you
That came about just really because I was using products at the time, and you know, you had to have one colorant for putting on the bare wood if you want to stain the wood. Another one for putting in the finish to do like a sunburst. Mm-hmm. And then another one to do touch up and repair and all this stuff. I got this crazy idea that, well, you know, maybe there's like, you could do one product to do, you know, everything. And I do have a pretty good science background, but I did not know enough of the chemistry. So I sort of went back to school, took some organic chemistry courses just so I could talk to people in the industry. And the result was I came up with a stain, which is really the go-to product now for people like Taylor, Gibson, Collings, Santa Cruz. And that to me was just, you know, the epitome of, mm-hmm. you know, making it.
Yeah.
But then, you know, I thought, well, you know, I've always loved to build guitars. Maybe I should try doing that again. So fast forward from 1980, no information on guitar building, to 2012, the internet, social media,
yeah.
nothing but guitar makers. So the world had really changed for the better too, mm-hmm. because there's a lot of information out there.
Yeah, tons of videos, tons of books have been published since then. And it seems like, as we were talking about last night, like luthiers are so forthcoming with sharing information with each other.
They are now.
And trading ideas. Yeah, apparently that wasn't always the case.
No. You call somebody up, a local guitar guy, if you could even find one, and it was like, well, I'm not going to tell you anything about how I do stuff.
Yeah,
you
know? Trade secret.
Yeah.
Yeah, not so much now. So when you first started, so you started with that Martin kit, and so how many did you build in that first stage after that?
I built two. I built a kit guitar, and then I built the from scratch guitar. Then I started doing a lot of repair work, which, boy, if you want to, it's a really good way to learn how to really up your luthery game if mm-hmm. you do repair work, because yeah. you see all the problems that mm-hmm. develop. The same thing with even, you know, I did antique furniture repair for years and years and years, and you would see what problems develop as a result of humidity and heat and all the things that, you know, we throw at furniture and guitars over years, and you see braces popping loose and things like that. Mm-hmm. So it's really invaluable stuff. And so that gave me a really good foundation when I got back into it of what right. I wanted to do. And so I started back in about 2012, and I made one more kit guitar, which was a Stuart McDonald kit, and then I can do this, I can do this. And so, but it's not an easy business, it really, yeah. to be honest with you, because there's a lot of people that do it. Mm-hmm. The boutique fad. Fortunately, we had a pandemic that just shot guitar sales through the roof, so it's been good in a way, but it's a fascinating business, because mm-hmm. to me, I've always had a very strong art background, but you're halfway through a build, okay? Like, you know, like this build is, you know, about ready to be finished and all that stuff. You're already thinking about what you want to do next. Mm-hmm. You know, like what kind of new neat thing you can do. Because you see all this stuff on social media that people are doing. And you go, well, so like it's a never ending chasing the tail of the dog, you know, to get better and up your game.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. But yeah. There's so many good people in this business, really, quite frankly. It's hard. So if, you know, somebody were going to get into it today, just I would apprentice with somebody. That's the yeah. way I would do it. And find somebody that you can apprentice to for two or three years, mm-hmm. and then, you know, find your own, you know,
yeah.
way.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting talking to so many different luthiers and seeing the different paths that people take to get into it. And there are some guys who maybe they work at a shop like Loudon or Martin or something like that, so they get that assembly line experience. Or a lot of folks just, they go to, you know, apprentice with Samaji or go to one of the schools and they start off on their own, and they're just from the get-go building, like, you know, one or two guitars at a time. And but yeah, I feel like doing something like apprenticing with another, like a luthier like you, somebody who's had a lot of experience, would be kind of the best of both worlds in a lot of ways.
Well, it is. And, you know, I mean, if I had to do it all over again, I would definitely not be self-taught. Now, mm-hmm. I'm self-taught. I know a few other luthiers, yeah. like Ryan Gerber is completely self-taught. And I mean, now there's a story right there. I mean, the second guitar he built, he took down to Nashville to have Phil Kagi critique it. Yeah. And he said, this is a great guitar. And Ryan was on his way.
Yeah. Yeah, some people can clearly be autodidactic and they're good to go.
Great word.
I feel like, yeah, that's a $5 word right there. Yeah. I feel like I'm not that kind of person myself. So I would offer the apprentice role.
But no, that would be the way that I would do it if mm-hmm. I had to do it again. Yeah. Definitely. And there's plenty of people out there that would... probably gladly take on an apprentice. You know, you might starve for a little bit, but you'll certainly get information and instruction that you can't get on your own.
Definitely. Yeah. And so, I mean, I have many other questions, but before we kind of dive off of that topic, I want to talk a little bit more about sort of the idea of being a luthier in like the current world, because I was just talking with another person about this and sort of what it takes to be successful. And like, you are such a great example of like the kind of self-employed luthier who is really good at social media and sort of the, I don't want to say the self-promotion side of things, because that, you know, but it kind of is in a sense, but you do it in a way where you're sort of inviting people into your workshop and you're inviting them to behind the scenes. And I think that's really compelling to a lot of people. And I think not everybody's ready to do that, but do you feel like that's a pretty big component of what you do?
Well,
or do you just particularly enjoy it yourself?
I have to be honest. I really was reticent to enter the social media mm-hmm. platforms. When I started my first business, the internet had just started. Mm-hmm. And so for me, that was the way that I sort of built my business. And then what I did was I associated myself with a famous woodworking magazine called Fine Woodworking, and I started writing articles for them. And I sort of promoted myself that way behind the scenes. Yeah. And I thought when I... later on took on the guitar world, I kind of do the same thing. Mm-hmm. It doesn't, you know, it was a completely different world. You have to get into social media. I mean, even, you know, advertising, although we do advertising, but advertising in the print media and that type of thing will get you nowhere fairly quickly mm-hmm. These days. But you have to get very savvy with the internet platforms and the ideas of social media and Instagram. Like somebody told me one time, do one post a day on Instagram. Just keep it up. And, you know, and then it just builds on itself. And then it's, and to just to return to this, it's much more of an open world now. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no secrets anymore.
Yeah.
There's no secrets. I wanted, here's a great example. I wanted to know how to do, I'd always wanted to do one of these, which is that beautiful inlaid wedge, mm-hmm. which is called an inlaid boxed wedge. And I just, you know, I would look at it, I'm scared to do it. How the heck do they do it? And I saw somebody doing it that's an Irish, or Irish or French, Drew Lowry, Guitars.
Irish living in France.
Yeah. And, he had it on one of his guitars. And so I just said, how the heck do you do that? And I wasn't expecting a response. He goes, oh my gosh, you're the Finnish guy. Well, yeah, I'll gladly tell you how I do it. And he just mapped it out, like step one, step two, step three, all the way through step 12. Yeah. And it was just, okay, easy peasy, I'm mm-hmm. done. And after I'd done about 12 of those, I did the steps on how I did it, okay? Mm-hmm. And sort of, you know, taking a little bit of the way he did it and I made it my own. And then this was like about 3 months ago, I saw somebody post the same exact thing. Like, how do you do that wedge on the end of the guitar? And the guy who's was doing the post said, well, you should go back to these old posts by Jeff Jewitt to see how he does it.
Yeah.
So it was like this continuing cycle, which is so cool if you think about it, of information and education.
Yeah.
But if you're not used to that, learning that way and sort of, you know, getting into that, you're going to be behind the crowd, I think.
Yeah.
So I guess that's a long-winded answer, but if I were to tell anybody, you know, apprentice with somebody and get an iPhone and just start posting like crazy.
Yeah, get good at taking the glamour shots and also be like kind of open and willing to share sort of the behind the scenes stuff. Because that's what people really enjoy seeing.
Yeah, it definitely,
Well, let's talk a bit about your influences.
Oh my.
Because your guitars, I mean, I think of them as sort of being, you kind of sit somewhere between the traditional modern spectrum a little bit. Like, you, there's obviously like the Martin sort of sizes, the 00, 00, OM and everything, but your guitars also do have a bit more of a modern look to them, and you do kind of delve into different fingerboard materials, and your rosettes are really distinctive. So yeah, what are your influences?
Well, my early influences, believe it or not, were really the people who are now the icons in the industry. Linda Manzer, Grit Laskin. I think you did an interview with him. Mm-hmm. And Richard Hoover, and then Bob Taylor, and then, you know, some of the real early influences, you know, were just, you know, the people that really are just at the top of their game right now. And, but again, it was very tough to learn back then. I would say most of my influences today, you know, obviously I, you know, pay homage to the people that got me started in this. But it's a lot younger crowd now. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, when somebody that's, you know, in their 60s can look up to somebody that's in their 40s going, the level of work you're doing is just phenomenal. I mean, that to me is really kind of cool. Mm-hmm. But like many, you know, I started with the classic Martin designs. Mm-hmm. Okay, I built O's, I built double O's, triple O's, OM's, I built dreads. And you should, if you're aspiring and you want to do this, you should, you know, you get to a point where you got to start making stuff your own. Mm-hmm. So then I started doing things like, well, I designed my own headstock. So now people see this headstock with the cat eye and diamond inlay. They go, that's a Jewitt. Mm-hmm. So I really don't even have to put Jewitt on here anymore.
Yeah.
Or Jewitt anywhere, because people know it. I started doing these solid rosettes. And I learned that off the internet too. And then I eventually got to the point where I just, you know, there's things I don't like about, like, the classic OM body shape, mm-hmm. like the Martin shape. So you start adding things that, you know, like arm bevels, mm-hmm. and then wedges, and then sound ports, and then, of course, a Florentine cutaway and all this stuff. And then I started, like, doing laminated sides, and then playing around with different bracing designs and all that stuff. And you eventually get to the point where you kind of get into your own groove. Mm-hmm. And that's where you want to be, is you want to hopefully get to the point where somebody will look at somebody and go, oh, that's a Jewitt. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's cool. I mean, that's really cool.
Yeah.
But I would say it's a lot of work. It really is.
Yeah.
But it's enjoyable. I mean, you know. And a lot of the early guitars that I built, I still have. You know, I don't, maybe eventually some, you know, but they're just, I use them as kind of like, you know, signposts along the way of mm-hmm. where I've been. And it's, but as I said, to return to this, there's always, always something new you can do. Mm-hmm. And I guess probably going forward, one of the things, I think there's a bunch of things I'd like to do, but I really am intrigued by changing the shape and the ergonomics of the guitar mm-hmm. to make it as player friendly as you can. Mm-hmm. So not just an arm bevel and, you know, maybe this, that, and the other thing, but the way it sits in the body.
Yeah.
And you see that with a lot of, like Gallup does that, Tyler Robbins does that. There's some, a few Japanese and Asian makers that do, Kathy Winger does like, this really cool, relieved arm or like mm-hmm. cutaway here. I mean, there's just, but to make it really, you know, just player friendly as much as possible. That to me is the challenge, I guess.
Definitely. Yeah. And I like that you kind of take the more subtle approaches with it, like with your 00, which here, I'm going to blame you for the fact that I'm probably going to buy a 00 one day because you change the way you do the lower bout. So it has a bigger presence, but it still has the comfort of that size, which is like perfect.
It's my favorite size. 00 I've always loved, but I always, you know, the Martin kind of standard 00 shape just sort of was, for lack of a better term, kind of boxy to me. So mm-hmm. I just, you know, I spent a whole winter, it was actually last winter, out there in the shop, just, you know, templates, drawings, and making dummies and things like this. And the first couple I did, I didn't like, so I changed them again. And they, I mean, you know, when you start doing that, that's a lot of time, because not only do you have to do prototypes, but you got to build all the molds, because you can't go out and just buy a mold. So you got to build all your own molds. You got to build all your own forms. But that's, you know, that's the benefit of doing this. And if you love doing it, then, you know, it's not a problem.
Yeah. Yeah. You've got that that constant desire to pursue the next best thing.
Yeah.
Which drives you. Well, speaking again of sort of tailoring guitars to player needs, I'd love to talk more about Matt Thomas's guitar, because he kind of went above and beyond with his list of demands. No, I don't want to say demands, but like his list of things that he really wanted to have tailored to his specific style, which is, I mean, that's such an incredible opportunity to get to have to both for both of you, for him to have that opportunity to get that guitar, but for you to also have that, like that really intense feedback and sort of explanation of why a particular player might want something. So,
well, you bring up a great point, which is another thing I would suggest to an aspiring, you know, builder that wants to, you know, get into the boutique market, mm-hmm. which is a specific market, but is find a musician, mm-hmm. find a musician that is, you know, very competent, and, you know, you may have to make the guitar for cost or mm-hmm. something like that, but, you know, but the feedback you get. So with Matt Thomas, this was a really, really challenge to me, because it just brought up things I'd never think. Matt is a 35-year-old, he's actually a Tommy Emmanuel protege. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you know that, but he studied he studied with Tommy for like 6 years or something like that. Amazing guitarist. And, I heard him play at Kent State, and I went, wow. And so I offered to build him a guitar. But Matt had really specific needs. Now, I did not know this, but, you know, players that get up on stage for 4 hours, you probably know this, it gets uncomfortable.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, it really wears and tears. And in Matt's case, he started having neck, shoulder, and back issues, mm-hmm. even though he's only in his mid-30s. Yeah. And I did more research on it, and I found out that, there's like chiropractors in like Nashville that do nothing but work on guitar guys, because those heavy Les Pauls and things like that. I never, you know, I'd always played sitting down. So what we did with Matt is I had him sort of come up with the ideas, and we co-designed a guitar that sat, he wanted some other things I cut away. But he placed the guitar like this, up mm-hmm. on stage, like a classical guitar. So instead of doing a normal, like, wedge, which would kind of, like, it's called a Manzer wedge, where it would kind of kick it forward like this if you're sitting down, well, he plays it like this. So we had to do an asymmetrical wedge, where the wedge actually goes from the smallest point here to the thickest point here.
Yeah.
Well, in terms of geometry of the whole, it was mind-blowing. So, Matt actually, we thought about it, So he actually got on a plane and came up here for a couple days, and we just sat down out there with pen and paper and some blocks of wood and things like that, and we got the rough shape down, and I built a prototype, and he said, yep, that's what I want, but he wasn't done yet. Then you get into the nitty-gritty.
Yeah.
Oh, I want this kind of fretboard. Oh, wait. Now, maybe I don't want a standard Martin length. I think I want a scale-length guitar I've never heard of before. You know, I mean, so I was like, you know, and then, you know, this, that, and the other thing. And then he wanted color in it. Now, I'd never done anything with colored, like, purfling mm-hmm. or lines. It was always just basic black or ebony or something like that. So, Matt bought all these sheets of different colored veneer and had them sent here. And then we picked out one that we liked. And then I taught myself how to make my own purfling and binding.
Wow.
So it was a big benefit to me. Yeah. And when you can offer that to your clients, mm-hmm. like say you're working with a potential client and you say something like, okay, well, I got an idea of like, you know, what kind of sound you want. What's your favorite color? Mm-hmm. Well, turquoise. Done. Right. How would you like to have a turquoise binding?
Yeah.
So it really, it was stuff like that. And, but boy, Matt really kept me busy, with, you know, pushing me to try new things that I never would do on my own.
Yeah.
And that's what was good.
Yeah.
Really good. And so I, and so we built him a guitar, and he flew up here. This was last December. He flew up here, got here about 11 o'clock in the morning, put his electronics in it. He did a quick 15-minute strum on it, and then he was doing a sound check at Kent State.
Jeez.
And I'm like, I can't believe you're doing this. Yeah. And I mean, So that was, I guess if we talk about bucket lists, you know, to see a really accomplished musician have one of your guitars on stage.
Yeah.
That was a very meaningful moment in my career. And that's something I'll really, really, really look back on fondly. Mm-hmm. But so anyways, that's a long-winded answer, I know.
No, that's such an interesting experience to get to have because, I mean, like you were saying, like you were trying things with Matt's guitar that you wouldn't necessarily think to do on just something that you were building for a store, but, and getting pushed to do that was, like, it's something where you might have walked away thinking, like, oh, actually, maybe I will bring that element into this next guitar or something like that. But I'm sure in a lot of cases, like, Matt's really specific needs might not be something that you'd want to do on every basic guitar.
So, no.
But knowing that you could do that, knowing that you can offer that, is really valuable.
With, I think, any discipline and, you know, artist or, you know, person that does a lot of work with their hands, it's easy to get kind of stuck into your own groove, if you will, mm-hmm. and just, you know, and to have that experience of, you know, really kind of having somebody go, you know, you got to try this, or this, that, and the other thing, it's very, very helpful. I would, you know, urge it to anybody. And you again, most people are going to balk at, you know, oh, I don't want to do that, or,
yeah.
you know, I don't like that, but it'll make you better.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think a lot of people they kind of draw the line on what they do and what they don't do. And so for you to be willing to do that and to go that extra step with that was, yeah, I think that really speaks to your kind of philosophy and your way of operating. Yeah. So going back to the idea of like getting into your you do with your guitars. What do you do for like bracing? You mentioned the laminated sides. What are some of the construction things that you have settled on as being sort of like, these are your go-to?
I'm still a big fan of the traditional Martin mm-hmm. concept of bracing, with the X brace mm-hmm. Being really, that's a structural nexus of a guitar. I don't like to experiment a lot with bracing because that can be a total disaster.
Interesting.
You know, particularly if it's a guitar that you sell to somebody. So I kind of stick with a traditional, we have kind of two choices in guitar making. We can do scallop bracing or tapered bracing. And there's benefits to both type of bracing stuff. I kind of combine the two, sort of like something that John Slobod does. Mm-hmm. And another thing John Slobod does, which I do frequently, is I forward shift most of my bracing. Mm-hmm. Because I do favor the smaller guitar size bodies, like the O's and the OM's, it does give you a little bit more bass mm-hmm. and mid-range presence when you do that. And so that's kind of something that I have settled on. The other thing that I've done is I've really settled, there's a really different vibe and sound that you get with the different species of bracing, like mm-hmm. Adirondack bracing
right.
versus Sitka versus some of the Euro sprucing. And one thing that I've been doing, which I did on this last guitar, I finally call it my inner species bracing guitar. We use Adirondack for the main X brace. And then for the tone bars, we use some European spruce. And for the finger bracing on the bass side, I use like German spruce. And for the finger braces on the treble side, I went to Italian spruce. And very surprising sound. Mm. I mean, you know, it's something I can discern, you know, I heard it in this guitar.
Yeah.
Now, there's other things that were going on that, you know, we really tried to formulate a sound for this particular client that he was looking for. But, you know, sometimes you just never know.
Yeah.
And then something that I started a couple years ago, which I would recommend to everybody, is understand some of the scientific scientific testing that you can do mm-hmm. during the build process to see where your build is going.
Right.
You can analyze frequencies. There's some simple apps that you can do with a microphone and a laptop or just an iPhone app. You can correct or push a guitar to a different sound before you put a finish and strings on it. Mm-hmm. And that's something I had to learn. So I had a great mentor, even though he's a lot younger than me. Ryan Gerber mm-hmm. taught me the ins and outs, really, of that. And then Michael Bashkin, to me, is a huge influence these days. Just an incredible, incredible technician. But the funny thing is Ryan and, you know, Michael and me, we're all wired completely different. Mm-hmm. I still have more of that studio fine arts background where, like, you know, I'll go out and, you know, if something isn't going right or whatever, I'll sort of like, you know, roll with the punches or whatever, you know, work it out. And, you know, I just don't get too rough. Whereas like with a lot of other guys, if you're wired a little bit tight, it can ruin your day. And just to bring this up, you know, one of the things that made, I want to say this whole craft a little bit easier for me was finishing. Now that's kind of the world I came from. That's the world I got to know really well. And I formulate finishes. I've made finishes. I've made colorants and things like that. So I know the ins and outs of it. But that's something that really is just the Achilles heel for most people getting
yeah.
there. Because you spend all this time on beautiful, and you can do beautiful work. And then if you can't put a good finish on it, you know, you're really disappointed. It will ruin your life very quickly.
Yeah. And if you just don't have the control over it, I mean, obviously you partner with somebody who you trust who can do the finishing for you, but it must be nice to be in charge of every step of that process.
Well, the thing is, there's a lot of things that can go wrong in finishing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, you can get drips, you can get, you know, soundboards that turn like green. I mean, I've had everything happen to me. And, you know, yeah, you just learn how to kind of fix it. But, you know, that's one I leg up that I guess I've always had, is that I'm not afraid of anything that happens during the finishing process. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I've had some real disasters, I must say. But, but you know, that's how you learn, quite
yeah.
frankly.
Yeah, for sure. Oh, yeah, let's talk about tone widths.
That's my favorite point.
Do you have any controversial opinions?
Well, I have lots of controversial opinions, but not specifically about tone widths. Well, I will say this. I, like everybody else, Brazilian rosewood is actually, if you can get decent wood, it's really an easy wood to work with. It bends very easily. It smells really good and all that. But I really love Cocobolo. Mm-hmm. I don't think I have a Cocobolo guitar here. In a little bit, I'll show you one that I'm building right now for a client. But Cocobolo can be a very nasty wood to work with.
Yeah.
Controversial opinion. I would say that right now there is a lot of talk about torrefied soundboards.
Mm-hmm.
And for those that don't know, a torrefied soundboard is a soundboard that's been heat treated mechanically to make it mature a little bit faster. And a lot of companies are exploiting that idea. I won't name anybody in particular, but you'll see like a lot of tone woods advertises maybe aged tone or heat treated or whatever.
Baked,
yeah, whatever. Tempered is even another word that's used. I'm not really on the bandwagon with mm-hmm. it. I still like a lot of the classical soundboards, but mostly what I use these days are European woods.
Mm-hmm.
I love German spruce. I've never had a disappointing experience with German. I love Swiss spruce. Moon spruce, we call it, is also a really good tone wood. And even some of the lesser known ones, the Carpathians, and I'm sure there's a, you know, German. Well, we went through German. What was the other one? But
Italian.
Italian. Yeah, Italian is a really good one. But it's something that if you're not careful, you can amass an awful lot of tone woods very quickly, because there's a lot of really neat stuff out there. Mm-hmm. I'm also a big fan, and we'll go out and we'll look at some of these in a second, but I'm also a big fan of some of the recycled, you know, aspects. Yeah. Of using the old redwood timbers that were in mines and railroad trestles. Yeah. Wonderful sound out of those, and looks and things like that. And then, of course, the salvage, like, you know, it's like the bog oaks over in Europe, or like the ancient Sitka that came on the scene not too long ago. But yeah, I mean, there's just a lot of woods that we can use that are already here that we don't need to go out and start, you know, decimating forests and, you know, countries to get good wood. But I think that day pretty much is kind of, I think over. I think we've reached a point in society where we can sustainably manage our forests and use what we have.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of good wood out there that people are recycling, which is, I always love to see that.
Yeah, like you've got all that sinker mahogany that you've used on some of the guitars we've had recently.
Oh, yeah, sinker mahogany. It's a wonderful, wonderful concept, because these are logs that otherwise would just be sitting in the bottom of rivers somewhere. Most of the sinker mahogany, like that Martin's using, and if you see it a lot of it comes from Belize, mm-hmm. Which is what, Central America, someplace like that, small country.
Yeah.
Because that's, you know, the old way of logging was, you know, logs would be transported down river from, you know, the woods where they cut them, and then they'd go and eventually sink, and people go in there to cover them. The famous tree was not sinker, but it was a tree that was so big it fell into a ravine.
And they just couldn't bring it out.
And they couldn't bring it out. Anyways, the sinker mahogany, we'll go take a look at some big planks I have. Mine, the stuff that I'm using, was actually recovered from the Hudson River.
Yeah, yeah.
So we did a little bit of research on it, and it's a fascinating story. But there was a guy, just to make a real quick story, there was a guy locally here in a suburb of Cleveland that was advertising on Craigslist. Mahogany for sale, big planks, you know, blah, blah, blah. And a friend of mine went down and checked it out. He goes, Jeff, you got to go down and see this stuff. And apparently this guy's nephew worked for a dredging company in New York, and they were dredging the Hudson River and pulling these big mahogany logs out. And he said to his uncle, who operates kind of a mom and pop sawmill here in town, he goes, do you want this stuff? He goes, yeah, sure. So we did a little research on it, and actually this was a sawmill that operated up until about the 1960s. And supplied all the mahogany to Martin and Gibson and these big furniture companies. And their sawmill, it was right there where it sunk. So we're able to use mahogany that originally would have wound up on a Martin from the 30s or the 20s during the golden era.
Yeah.
And, I mean, just the look of this stuff is just incredible. Yeah. But the sound is really, really quite unique. Mm-hmm. And there's been some very knowledgeable people. George Gruen is one I can think of. He thinks the sinker mahogany that's on guitars today is equivalent to the, you know, the old stuff.
Yeah.
But I really like working with it, and I've got some big planks of it out there. We'll show you in just a little bit. This is also sinker mahogany, and that's not sinker mahogany. That's just regular kind. That's a weird mahogany. It's kind of orange colored.
Yeah, it's really...
It's called tropical mahogany.
Oh, okay.
And it's just sort of like an orangey color.
Is that like the African mahogany, or is that still from...
It's not African,
Central
no.
America?
It's I don't know where it's from. It's probably from, you know, someplace in Central America or something like that. Mm-hmm. But mahoganies have a really expansive growing range.
Yeah.
But the classic ones, the Honduran mahogany, is more specific to certain areas, obviously Honduras and Belize and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big mahogany fan. Other tone woods, I've, like everybody else, have experimented with some of the alternatives of Wenge, Cataloche, not Catalogs.
Yeah, Cataloche.
And They don't wow me. They don't wow me. So I kind of stick to what I, you know, are the tried and true tone woods. But we get a lot of requests for the sinker mahogany.
Yeah. Let's talk about finishes a little bit, because obviously you have way more experience than I think a lot of folks do. And you've been in the finishing business for a long time, but you also have, do you have experience with all the different types? So have you done French polish, polyurethane, nitrocellulose? Have you done it all?
I've done them all.
Yeah.
I've done them all. The first guitars I did, I French polished.
Mm-hmm.
The second guitar I finished with aerosol spray cans of lacquer I bought from Stuart McDonald. I did that in my garage at home, and my wife objected to the smell, and that's how I got my first shop eventually, but you know, that's a longer story. I got booted out. I tried water base, and not wowed by it. Doesn't have that classic look. I used lacquer, like everybody else, for a nitrocellulose lacquer for a very long time, which is what basically Martin, Gibson, even PRS uses lacquer this day. Santa Cruz, Collins, everybody, you know.
Yeah.
It has a lot of benefits. It came on the scene in the 30s, and really, it's there's a lot of good things about it. But it just isn't durable enough for me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for instance, like one of my I don't like pick guards.
Mm-hmm.
I just, you know,
yeah.
It sort of throws everything off, particularly if you spend a lot of time on the rosette.
Mm-hmm.
So I use what is called a urethane or catalyzed urethane finish, mm-hmm. which has kind of like a negative connotation. Oh, you're using poly or, you know, but applied correctly, it's a very durable finish.
Mm-hmm.
You can get away with not using a pickguard. And it really keeps the guitar looking very, very good for a long period of time and does not require a lot of you know, like weird cleaners and stuff like that. You know, I don't tell this to people, but, you know, you can clean one of my finishes with Windex if you want to.
Wow.
But it's just, it's very durable because it's equivalent to what's on your car.
Yeah.
But the real secret with it is you have to learn how to apply it as thinly as possible, because if there's a lot of things that luthiers disagree on, but one thing that we do kind of all agree on is you should probably, at least on the soundboard, keep the finish as thin as possible.
Yeah.
And so that requires a fair amount of technique and stuff like that. But I know that a lot of guys, you know, girls, you know, when they build a guitar, their big moment is putting the strings on.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it's that first coat of finish when it's in the spray booth, and then all of a sudden that wood just like goes, whoa.
Yeah, I love when you get those, when you do those behind the scenes
in the spray booth. I do a lot of that because, well, it just
totally transforms.
Well, it wows me so much. I have to share it with other people. Like, for instance, like I can't wait to get this in the booth, because this is one of the cleanest German spruce soundboards I've ever seen. Almost as good as John's right here.
Mm-hmm.
And then this sinker mahogany, but I use Cocobolo. I made my own binding on this. It's Cocobolo.
Oh, nice.
And so it's that first coat of finish. And then, of course, this is a Cocobolo fretboard, which is kind of like really, really kind of outrageous.
Yeah, really striking.
So this will go to the Artisan Guitar Show this April. It'll make its debut, and I've already had some people interested on it. Another benefit of social media, folks, is that, you know, if you sort of like tease the public, you know, you'll get some, you know, you'll actually get some response. And I've had several sales result just from stuff I've done, little video reels in the spray booth. So it works.
Yeah. One question I wanted to ask, so poly versus like nitrocellulose, isn't one of the benefits with nitro that it's fairly easy to repair?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So
and that's the reason that most guitar companies use it these days, because invariably you're going to get some nicks and scratches and stuff on the way to the dealer.
Yeah.
And you know, it's pretty easy to fix those things. Urethane is a little bit more little tougher.
But do you find that it doesn't get as dinged and nicked up as a nitro is?
No, I mean, any guitar, if it gets, you know, abused enough, will get dinged. But it resists the minor scuffs and scratches of shipping containers and maybe rubbing inside a case that's inside a box and things like that.
Yeah. And playing, because if you don't, if you don't need to use a pick guard, if it's strong enough to withstand that, then that's a pretty good longevity sign.
Yeah, well, the thing is, again, with a urethane finish, you know, you can clean it with soap. So, yeah, we tell people basically just use like some Dawn dishwashing detergent on a little kind of a damp cloth. It'll clean it right up. But it doesn't scratch, you know, like if you use like a microfiber cloth, sometimes you'll get very hairline scratches on a lacquer finish. And that's, but once I switched over to urethane, I just wasn't having problems that you will get specifically. A real big problem a lot of times is, you know, I build in a climate that's Cleveland, Ohio. It's, you know, kind of the Midwest, but it's, you know, really cold and dry in the winter, and it's really hot and humid in the summer. And, you know, you ship a guitar in like February or March from here to, say, like Florida or something like that, you're asking for trouble.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, you know, all sorts of things can happen. I just don't have that problem with urethane finishes. So it's a win-win for me.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of other finishes. I would recommend if somebody were starting out in, you know, building guitars, is there's some good finishes that you can use on your first guitar. So they're kind of wipe-on finishes. They may not be gloss, but they're sort of like a satin stuff. And as much as we've tried as luthiers in the industry to convince people that satin finishes are great, and, you know, I mean, because they are quite a little bit easier, but the public generally wants gloss.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the way it goes. But if you're really serious and you want to compete in the boutique market, I would probably recommend finding somebody and contract it out. And just, I know a number of people that do that because they just don't want to set up a spray booth. They don't want to be hassled with things that go wrong and things like that.
And and you have to comply with environmental codes and everything. So that's kind of a next step that, just not everybody has the space for or the know-how to really do well. So,
But, if not, then I would just say get good with lacquer, nitrocellulose lacquer on your first maybe 5, 10, 15 guitars, something like that, and then try something different. Every year now for the past couple of years, Robbie O'Brien and I have been teaching a class on how to do a urethane finish on a guitar. And we can actually do a complete finish from raw wood like this to buffed like this in 5 days.
Wow. So it's possible.
Yeah, it's so, but it's it's a good way to go if you can. It reduces a lot of bottlenecks. But as I, as we mentioned, a lot of the big companies don't do it. What they do is they do lacquer. They may use a performance polyurethane or polyester or something like that to like fill the grain and get like the base coat, what we call sealer coats on the guitar, and they'll even cure those with UV lights now to really speed it up. And then, but then they'll put lacquer on top of that.
Gotcha. I see. Well, so you just briefly mentioned the your teaching with Robbie. That's a market. So I kind of want to touch on things that you're doing this year, like where people can find you and see you and learn from you or see your guitars. And you mentioned Artisan, which is coming up in a couple months.
I'm doing the Artisan Guitar Show this April 14th, somewhere mid-April or something like that. It's a smaller show. Well, I shouldn't say smaller show, but it's a, I think it's the first regional show kind of the year. It's close to Philadelphia, but it's a three-day show, so it's not like a real extended period of time. I'll be, not only will I be exhibiting there, but I'll be giving a presentation on a brief history of how American guitar finished, or how American guitars were finished like about 1833 to the present.
Awesome.
And that was really cool because I interviewed all the big names. I did interviews with Bob Taylor, Richard Hoover at Santa Cruz, Dana Bourgeois, and got kind of their feedback and things like that. And it's real. I learned a lot, actually. And then I'll be doing a presentation on that. And then I'll be doing, I think, I wrote an article for the magazine, which will be handed out. But that will be a lot of fun. I'm teaching a class in July with Robbie O'Brien at the Mark Adams School of Woodworking, which is in Indiana, and that will be not 5 days this year, that will be 7 days. So we're going to have some time to deviate on like how to do like grain filling and some of the other things. And so that will be a lot of fun. That course is a go, as far as I know. We have about half signed up, so there'll be some more. And then I have an Instagram, YouTube channel. I'm one of these guys that I just like to do it all. Like right now, I'm teaching myself DaVinci Resolve for film editing. Mm-hmm. That's like a whole new world. And I just did my first video here, you know, right here in the office where we had two cameras set up. And that was, you know, to do that yourself, you know.
Yeah.
Now, if you have help, somebody else, you know, setting things up, that's one thing. But to get everything lined up and, you know, by
so
yourself.
Hard.
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know this because yeah. You do this too. But
I get to have Zane do most of it now, which is great.
Yeah. It's nice to have help. Mm-hmm. But I just enjoy it. It's for me, it's just it's never ending things to, you know, try out and do and get better at. And mm-hmm. That's the whole name of the game. It's just, you know, just getting better and upping your skills. And so it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to get into. And as I said, when I first started in this business, it was just like nobody would help you out. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you were on your own. Nowadays, it's like people will practically jump off the your iPhone to help you out. You know, it's just a whole different world. So it's really cool.
Yeah,
it's really cool.
Yeah, it's very, very collaborative.
Yeah.
Well, before we head out to the workshop, just a couple kind of rapid fire questions I like to say for the end. Coffee or tea for powering your day? I think I know the answer. But
coffee in the morning, segue into tea, and definitely tea at night.
Yeah.
Anything past, I think I would say 3 or 4 o'clock, I've got to be tea.
Yeah. Herbal tea or still
herbal
black?
Tea.
Yeah.
Ginger mango.
Mm. Delicious.
Yeah.
Any podcasts or albums that you are really excited about and enjoying while you do you listen to things while you work?
I find myself it's distracting to me a little bit. I've tried it a couple times. The earbuds keep falling out. I tried headphones, and then I can't hear anything that's going on.
Yeah.
No, I tend to really like silence when I work. And that's just, you know, that's just me. As far as podcasts go, well, of course, I love anything that you guys do at the North American Guitar, which is now Carter Vintage, you know, sort of all folded up into one big, beautiful pie now. And I love Michael Bashkin's podcast that he does for the Fretboard Journal.
Yeah.
Those are really, really, really illuminating. Ian Davlin, which is kind of more of a repair guy, he does a bunch of podcasts. He interviews a lot of interesting people. Anything that TJ Thompson does is, I'm there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm there. I mean, there's heroes that I have, and TJ's really up there as far as just one of them.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much it. I'm still in some ways, I'm kind of like old school in that, you know, I do look at print.
Yeah.
A lot. I do like holding a book, quite a bit. I was slow to this, but about a year ago, I finally bought the, Gorgelet books, mm-hmm. which is Design and Construction and then Execution. It's a two series book. And, that to me was an eye opener. It was like, oh wow, okay, that's how they do that.
Interesting.
That's how, yeah. So there are some really good ways to learn this. I would say, out in the shop, I have an employee that is kind of running the stain business while I'm doing guitars, and I'm listening to her music and her TV shows and everything else while I'm working, so I get plenty of that.
Yeah, so you get the outer stimulus.
I get enough of that stimulus.
Yeah. Have there been any albums that you've discovered recently that you really enjoyed?
You know, it's funny you said that. That's not a question I was expecting. But
I love to hear people's musical backgrounds,
okay.
too, because obviously it's musical instruments.
There was, in the 70s, okay, there was a female singer called Carla Bonoff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you've heard the name.
Yeah, I've heard the name.
Carla Bonoff. And she was one of these female singers that was sort of pushed into being the next Linda Ronstadt. Mm, exactly. And, you know, like, okay, you know, and back in the 70s, of course, you know, it was probably suggested that she put on a bikini and walk down a sunset beach, and that would be the album cover. It was obviously that was not her shtick. She did a couple of albums, but I remember that she had a couple hit songs, and then I just sort of forgot about her. But I was listening the not too long ago. I listened to I was trying to figure out an arrangement of The Water Is Wide, the old classic folk song.
Yeah.
And her version came up and it just floored me
really?
How good it was. Mm. And her voice and her guitar playing. So I went back to it, and apparently what she did is in the 70s she just disappeared and she became a songwriter. She wrote hit songs for Bonnie Raitt, Linda Ronstadt, and a bunch of other people, Roseanne Cash.
Oh, I think, yeah, I think I've seen her credited on some
of
those songs before.
So she became a singer-songwriter, just behind the scenes, maybe raised a family or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then when she was like 71, okay, she released an album, okay, and I listened to it, and it's fantastic.
Nice.
So Carla Bonoff, for a big pitch for Carla Bonoff.
Yeah.
not a name you'll hear a lot of, but yeah, just really, really just, you know, almost in that Carole King kind of singer-songwriter groove.
Cool.
Not maybe the greatest range, you know, not a pretty voice, but just, you know, just the phrasing, you know, and, you know, which is, of course,
musical.
What makes it. Yeah, I'm very musical. You know, I'm very eclectic in what I listen to. And you know, obviously you would think, you know, obviously the Tommy Manuel and, you know, the Norman Blake, the Pickers, you know, the acoustic guitar people. But I really love, you know, going back into some of the old, like Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong albums, the old 50s jazz, and then, who did I follow? Miles Davis, My Goal Is Beyond. I hadn't heard that in ages. And I just went, whoa! You know, and I remember when I was in high school, I have friends that were really into jazz. They were trying to get me to listen to it. And of course, I was into like Grateful Dead and, you know, I don't want to listen to that and all that stuff. And then, you know, but you just learn, you know, and it's funny how, you know, musical tastes just shift and things like that. And then you kind of got me into a little bit of a Celtic thing. You know, I started listening to... you posted a soundtrack or something that you were listening to, and I listened to it the other day, and I went, this is the first Celtic music I've heard where I actually understand the lyrics.
Yeah, that was my friend Louis Scuderi's new album. So
oh, yeah, that's his name. Yeah, yeah, it was funny. It was like, this is intelligible. It's not like and, you know, and then Richard Thompson, I adore. Mm-hmm. And my wife, she's very funny because she goes, he's the only British singer who actually sounds like he's British.
It's kind of true,
You know, it's like all the other, like, you know, you listen to the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, they just sound like, you know, they're just sort of Americanized or something like that. But yeah, he's got that, you know, real British type of groove going. And then, you know, to me, it was just so, so amazingly cool that Bonnie Raitt won Song of the Year.
Awesome.
At the last Grammys. I mean, what, she's 71, 72. And, you know, I just... to have a really good artist win the Grammy, to me, was just, that was icing on the cake. That was great. I was very, very, very happy for her.
Yeah. Yeah, it's always nice when that happens.
So what do you say? Your question is something? Would you guys like a tour?
Yeah, let's do a tour.
Workshop? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Awesome. Sounds cool. All right. So where do you want to start? You just want to kind of, I could just say...
I'm already going.
You're already going. Well... welcome to Jewitt Guitars. We're going to give you a short tour as to basically how we take pieces of wood and we eventually get a guitar out of it at some point. So follow me. Everything starts over here, and we're in a really old building here. This building, I think, was started in the late 1800s. We have huge wooden rafters and beams and all that kind of stuff. It's just a cool old building with these big glass block windows that let in plenty of light. But everything starts over here in the wood stash. And sometimes we buy sets of wood that are already thinned down pretty much to sides and backs like that. But a lot of wood we actually cut ourselves. And so we've got, this is what I buy, a sinker mahogany. And these are big planks. Here's some curly maple here. Here's some cocobolo. And then, of course, Brazilian rosewood. And then we'll cut these down into smaller pieces. And then over here, we have a bandsaw, which will then take something like about that big. And then we can do the backs. So we'll resaw this. We'll probably get about maybe, well, at least four. If I'm really good and the saw blade is sharp, I might be able to get six sets or six backs out of that. Basically, once we get the back and sides done, we go over here and we have a machine, which is just a very standard machine, which is a bender, which then bends the wood into the sides of the guitar. And then once we get the sides bent and the back cut, then we start gluing everything together. This is a cocobolo guitar that's in the mold. And so the sides have been bent into the shape with the cutaway, and these linings have been installed, which is what the back will get glued to. And we eventually will have this back, which has now been braced, and we've tuned it optimally. And then this will get glued down to that, and then we'll go to work on the soundboard after that's done. So nothing goes to waste. Typically, all the off cuts, you can't go throw away any of this wood. What we'll do with those is we'll at some point, so these are all little small pieces of wood, which will make the solid wood rosette.
Okay.
There's a mosaic rosette. That's mm-hmm. probably gonna go on that guitar. So we've taken actual pieces of purfling, binding, all the different woods, and this will eventually get cut out into a small ring for the rosette.
Yeah.
So this is an awful lot of fun.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
So making little puzzles.
Little puzzles. And so once that's all done, follow me. The guitar gets built, and then it goes over here into the finish room. And this is where the good stuff happens. Now, this is also probably where a lot of my luthier friends are also gonna like look at this and go, oh my gosh, that's nice. So we do have a pretty nice spray booth here. We're all complying with local codes and ordinances. We had the Cleveland Fire Department in here and sign off on everything. We've got sprinklers on and all that kind of stuff, filters. But yeah, so the guitars all get finished in here. And then once that's done, they dry for about a week or so, and then we go out here again to the buffing process. And we have two buffers which are used to put the final gloss on the guitars. So I have one, and this is also something that drives my luthier friends crazy. I don't have one buffer, I have two. Okay, so we've got one, because I hate changing wheels. So I have one, this is the medium and coarse compounds, and those are the super fine compounds.
Oh, okay.
So, and so that's basically it. It's, you know, as you can see, it's kind of always in a state of disarray, and it's amazing to people like my wife and other people that come in here that these beautiful guitars come out of this sort of madness that goes on in here. But it is something that is quite rewarding once you get everything done.
Mm-hmm.
I should mention, I suppose, you know, as part of my travels is we also make all the stains
mm-hmm.
for the people that, you know, really build guitars, like Taylor and Gibson and all that. That's all done over here. So over here we build guitars. On the other side, we actually make stains. We basically take a liquid, pump it into a bucket like this, And then what we do is then we go over here and then I have formulas and we add all the different colors to it and mix it all up in one happy liquid. So we'll take red, blue, green, yellow, brown, and all that stuff. These are all different colors, and we make all the colors that you see in like in a typical guitar sunburst. And then these are dispensed in these right here. So this is all our colors that we make. And it is sort of, I want to say it's a Jekyll and Hyde thing, because this is really messy over here. And then it's not uncommon that, like, I'll be working over here and I'll get all sorts of different dyes and colors on my hands or something or in my hair. And then I go wipe down a soundboard with water and I get little blue dots on it.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So anyways, but so this is J.B. Jewitt.
This is the palace.
This is the palace. Magic happens. This is where, yeah, this is where it all happens. And anyways, it's my world. Welcome to it.
Thanks for listening to this episode of Talking Guitar. We have a beautiful quartet of Jewitt guitars in the shop right now, including two of my personal favorites, which are Jeff's take on the 00 design, one in walnut and redwood, and the other in Italian spruce and figured Indian rosewood, as well as a very unique white oak 00 and a cedar cocobolo OM. And of course, if you're interested in ordering a custom model through us, Kim or I would love to help you. Links to Jeff's site, all available guitars, and our contact info will be in the show notes below. As always, more Luthier chats are coming up next with Frank Sly of Sylvan Guitars, Simon Haycraft of Preston Thompson, and more. So be sure to check back next week for the latest episode.